Welcome everybody. My name is Jan-Niklas Reinhardt. I'm a PhD student at the Albert Einstein Institute in Hanover, and I'm working on carbon filtering in the initial noise reduction pipeline, which is also the topic of my talk today. Before the launch of LISA in 2034, we need to make sure that the data analysis algorithms are working properly and that they are able to extract the gravitational wave signals from the LISA raw measurements. In order to do so, we need an end-to-end simulator for LISA. Here on this slide, you can see a flowchart of such an end-to-end simulator. On the upper part of the slide, you can see the simulation of the LISA raw data, which could be done using LISA Node. The simulated raw data is then inserted into the data processing pipeline. Within this data processing pipeline, the initial noise reduction pipeline, abbreviated as INRIP, is the first stage. The main goals of INRIP are the cancellation of the otherwise overwhelming laser frequency noise and the synchronization of the clocks. Why should we use a Kármán filter in INRIP? Well, first of all, the setup is well posed for a Kármán filter, because what we have in hand is on the one side a dynamic model of the whole LISA constellation. We know the orbits, and we also have the power spectral density of the clock jitters, because they can be measured on Earth before the launch of the mission. On the other side, we have the phase meter raw measurements, and these two packages of information constitute complementary information. A clever way to combine complementary information is to use a Kármán filter. Secondly, we need to decouple the light traveling times and the differential clock jitters in the pseudo ranges. That will be discussed later on in this talk. First of all, I would like to give a brief introduction to Kármán filtering. In general, the goal of Kármán filtering is to find optimal estimates of a system's state vector. In the case of LISA, such a state vector could consist of the positions and the velocities of the three spacecraft, the timing and frequency jitters of the ultra-stable oscillators. So this would give us a 24-dimensional state vector. However, there are alternatives to this state vector. This slide gives us a schematic overview of the Kármán filter algorithm. We are considering a one-dimensional system here, and the state vector is displayed as probability density function. Basically, the Kármán filter is a two-step algorithm. In the first step, we are considering a system model that is telling us how the state vector of the system is propagating in time. During this propagation of the state vector to the subsequent time step, the uncertainty increases, the state spreads, because our system model is not perfect. If it was perfect, we wouldn't have to take measurements. In the second step, the correction step, we are taking a measurement of the system. Here we need an observation model that is telling us how our observables are related to the state vector components, because usually we cannot measure directly the state vector components. So then, after the measurement, we have two states, the propagated state and the measured state. And in the correction step, we are combining these two states to get a corrected state with decreased uncertainty that is depicted in green here. And then we are propagating again. Let me say a few more words about the system model and the observation model for a linear system. Here you can see the system model of a linear system. Xk is the state vector at time k. K is the time label here. It is not a labeling the state vector components. That's important here. The first term in this equation is telling us how the state vector is propagated in time. The state vector at previous time is related to the state vector at current time by the so-called state transition matrix F, which is part of the system model. The second term is the input term. Uk is the input vector, which is telling us how physical input would affect the system. If we, for example, burn fuel, this term would tell us how the system would be accelerated or decelerated, etc. Of course, our system is not perfect. We need to include that by including this process noise vector omega k here. Then we have the observation model of the linear Kármán filter. As I said, we cannot directly measure the state vector x. we can measure certain observables which are collected in the measurement vector y. And these observables are related to the state vector by the observation matrix H. Of course, our measurements are not perfect, so we need to take into account measurement noise, and that's called VK. VK is the measurement noise vector, and the measurement noise is uncorrelated to the process noise, of course. Let me now introduce the LISA system model that is telling us how the 24-dimensional state vector that I introduced before is propagated in time. This LISA system model can be divided into an orbit model and a clock model. In the first equation, you can see the solar system dynamics of a single spacecraft to Newtonian order. This can be rewritten as orbit model that is expressing the time derivative of the orbital part of the state vector in terms of the state vector itself. And in addition, we have the process noise. Of course, that orbit model is not linear, so we need to linearize it in order to insert it into the Karman-Felder algorithm presented before. The dynamic equation for the clock jitters and frequency jitters depend on the specific clock and on how well we characterize the clock. Here you can see a simple dynamic model for the clocks that is expressing the time derivative of the timing jitter as frequency jitter. So in this model, we treat the timing jitter as accumulative effect of the frequency jitters, and the frequency jitters are treated as process noise. Here you can see the full LISA system model for a single spacecraft, and the state transition matrix would be the matrix exponential of the matrix on the right hand side. Let me now introduce the LISA observation model. Here you can see the LISA measurements that would be relevant for a Karman filter. These are in particular the long arm measurements, the PRN ranging, the science beat nodes, and the clock sideband beat nodes. Also, the on-earth position tracking that is performed in the MOC, in the Mission Observation Center, might be useful. As an example, I will discuss here the pseudo-random noise ranging and the corresponding observation model. So all in all, we have six PRN ranging measurements, one for each laser link. A pseudo-random noise code is modulated onto the transmitted laser beam, and this modulation is done with respect to the ultra-stable oscillator of the sending spacecraft. On the receiving spacecraft, we are comparing that PRN code to an exact local copy, but that exact local copy was set up to the according to the local ultra-stable oscillator. So, by time shifting and correlating these two codes, we can deduce the light traveling time plus the differential clock error. That brings me to the observation model. So the observable is this PRN ranging measurement, but that is not part of the state vector. So we need to express it in terms of the state vector components, which is done here in the observation model. So we can express this observable as the distance between the spacecraft, which is given by this Pythagoras D12. And in addition, we need to include the differential clock error, because these timing jitters are also part of the state vector. And we need to include the measurement noise. Of course, this is only a model, and it is a very simple model with a bunch of approximations. For example, we are not considering the light travel times, instead we are considering the arm lengths here. And the consideration is non-relativistic, and last but not least, the delays are not considered in the clock errors. But this observation model is good enough for a first prototype of the Karman filter. Later on, it should be refined though. So now I can come back to the goal of Karman filtering in INRIP. We have a 24-dimensional state vector here, but only 18 measurements. So we don't have enough information to precisely determine each state vector component. But we don't need to know each state vector component precisely. What we need to know is the light travel time, and we need to have synchronized clocks. So we can say that we need to disentangle the arm length and the differential clock jitter and the pseudo ranges. And that can be done by a Karman filter. It was already shown by a former PhD student at the Albert Einstein Institute. In the last month, I created such a common filter for Lisa, and I would like to present you the software architecture of this common filter. I created a module for the system model, and another module for the observation model, and a third module for the common filter algorithm itself. Then I created a configuration interface so that the user can choose between different clock and orbit models and between different observation models. In addition, the user can set the process noise and the measurement noise. All that can be done in the main file. Here you can see again the common filter algorithm as presented before, the propagation step, the measurements are taken into account, and then the updating step, and then it is propagated again. This common filter, however, is a very particular common filter because we don't have a uniform sampling time. That's important here. What we have is we have three clocks at different gravitational potentials, and these three clocks are jittering independently. For that reason, the state vector contains also the timing jitters. So what we need to do here is we need to run the common filter repeatedly. After the first run, we take the timing jitters that were computed in the first run, and we use them to correct the timestamps so that in the second run, the measurements are taken into account step by step, part by part, each at the corresponding measurement time. This is done by a sequential count filter. The second point is that the estimates at the beginning are less accurate than the estimates at the end. So after the first run, we need to run backwards the common filter. This is a technique called optimal smoothing. And finally, it might make sense to use posterior data to obtain more precise estimates. At the end, the data of Lisa will arrive in certain chunks. So let's say we get one chunk data every day. So at the first day, we can compute rapid estimates for the common filter state vector. On the second day, then again, we compute the rapid estimates for the second day, but we can compute also medium estimates for the first day using the data chunks that is arrived at the second day. And at the third day, then we can also compute the final estimates for the first day, and so on. And in this picture, the rapid estimates would be part of a quick alert system. Jan Wang, a former PhD student at the Albert Einstein Institute, has written a first version of Lisa Kármán filter connected to a simple Lisa simulator. Here I took the measurement data from his Lisa simulator and imported it into my Kármán filter. And these are the results for the estimation of the clock jitter. In red, you can see the deviation of the raw measurements, of the simulated raw measurements from the simulated two values. In blue, you can see the deviation of the Kármán filter estimates from the simulated true values in case of the clock jitters. My results are perfectly matching the results of Jan Wang, and moreover, you can see that the Kármán filter is reducing the uncertainty in the clock jitter estimation. Here you can see the same for the arm length estimation. Also here, the Kármán filter is reducing the uncertainty. That was my presentation. Thanks for your attention. Here are my references.